dear learners, for this course on design of machine elements 1. From today's lecture, we are heading to start a new topic of discussion, that is design for static strength. As the name itself indicates, we will be discussing the design of machine elements which are subjected for static loading conditions. The static loads are defined as the loads which are applied at a particular point of a machine element whose magnitude will be varying from 0 to its maximum value. Once the maximum magnitude of the load is reached, there will not be any further increase in load or direction of application or point of application. Hence, the acceleration of this load can be neglected, hence they are termed as static loads. Therefore, we can state the static loads as the loads whose magnitude and direction will not vary once the maximum magnitude of the load is reached. Once the maximum magnitude of the load is reached, we don't vary the point of application or the magnitude or the direction of application. Such loading conditions are termed as static loading conditions. The machine members can be subjected for direct loading, pure bending, torsional loading, or probable combination of these three loading cases. As we all know, entire machine design depends on three basic equations, that is direct loading analysis, bending equation and torsion equation. The catch for design of machine elements subjected for static loading is that you people should be able to identify whenever you see the loading condition whether it is subjected for pure direct loading or for pure bending or for pure torsional loading or probable combination of these three loading cases. Once you identify these conditions, then you can use suitable formula for that and design the machine member. Before entering to solve or design the actual machine elements subjected for starting loading conditions, in today's lecture, let us discuss the prerequisites required, that is how to identify, depending on the loading condition, whether it is subjected for pure direct, pure bending or pure torsional loading conditions or probable combination of these three loading conditions. Let us discuss this first. So today's topic, we are heading to discuss design for static strength. So first, let us discuss the prerequisites. As I said, the machine members can be subjected for pure direct loading. So probable loading cases. Coming for probable loading conditions, first one is pure direct stress loading. To produce two pure direct stress, either tensile loading or compressive loading. Next is pure bending. Next we have pure torsion. Now coming for the probable combination of these loadings, we can have direct plus torsion, or we can have bending loading plus torsion. Or we can have combination of combined direct comma bending and torsion, all these three. Let us take it as pure direct loading case. Which either it can cause tensile or compression. Now, before designing the machine elements subjected for static loading cases, we should be able to identify, based on the loading condition, to what category the problem lies. Either it is coming for pure direct loading case, or for pure bending case, or for pure torsional case, or probable combination of these three basic loading conditions. Let us discuss it one by one. Let us take pure direct loading. So if I take first one, pure direct loading. So in case of pure direct loading, let me take an example and discuss. If I have a machine element, let us say it is like a cantilever beam, if I take the centroidal axis, the load line or line of action of load should coaxial with the centroidal axis. So the line of action of load and the centroidal axis are coincide. Such loading cases comes under the category of pure direct loading. Depending on the direction of load, whether it is acting towards the center or away from the center, we can detect it as tensile load or compressive load. So for pure direct loading, the line of action of load should be coaxial with centroidal axis. So such direct loading cases will have total stress induced as sigma total will be equal to Q direct sigma direct, so which is equal to force by area. Now coming for second loading case, we have pure bending. So this is an example for bar element, because bars are subjected to axial loading cases, whereas beams are subjected to both axial and transverse loading cases. Bars won't experiment bending moment or shear force, whereas beam experience shear force and bending moment because of the reason they will having transverse loading cases. So since the load is coaxial, this is a very good example for bar element. Now coming for pure bending loading, for pure bending loading, so if I consider a cantilever beam as an example, like this, the line of action of force should be perpendicular to the centroidal axis. So if I draw the centroidal axis of this machine member, you can see the line of action and the centroidal axis are orthogonal to each other. So for pure bending loading cases, line of action of force should be perpendicular to centroidal axis. So in such cases, the total stress induced will be equal to pure bending. So which is nothing but bending moment into distance of the outer fiber from centroidal axis divided by moment of inertia, md into c by i, this you already know. Now coming for third case of loading condition, third case of loading condition is pure torsion, for which generally we have externally applied torque like this. We have externally applied torque and we know the magnitude of torque, or there should be in plane shear, or there should be in plane shear. Let us say we have a plate like this, for which I have fixed another plate, so using welding or riveting like this. So I have fixed it. So now if I apply a force here, this will cause shear. So this is not example for bending, this is in plane shear, torsional stress will be induced. So whereas I can measure the torque as distance from CG to load line, which I can treat it as L. So therefore in such cases, torque induced will be F into L. So for pure torsional cases, we can have the total stress will be only shear. So we know that from torsion equation, T by J is equal to tau by R. So therefore we'll be having the equation as T by J is equal to tau by R. So therefore TR by J, where J is nothing but polar moment of inertia. For circular sections, if we have the total pure torsion stress can be determined as 16 T by pi d cube for circular cross sections machine element. I don't know whether this is circular or rectangular or square cross section. Depending on the cross section, I can use the general expression. If it is a circular cross section, I can use directly the stress, shear stress is equal to 16 T by pi d cube. So this is the very good examples of machine element subjected for pure direct loading, pure bending and pure torsion. Now let us discuss the probable loading cases, that is combination of loading cases, coming for combined loading cases. Under combined loading cases, we have case number 4, that is direct and torsion. If a machine member is subjected for direct and torsional loading cases, like I have a direct loading case for which I will apply a torque. So such cases, we have the total stress will be sigma total should be calculated with the help of sigma principal stress. So therefore, we know that from maximum principal stress theory, sigma will be sigma direct by 2 plus square root of sigma direct by 2 whole square plus tau square. So use this equation for direct plus torsional loading cases, that is coaxial loading with externally applied torque. Now moving for case number 5, if we have bending and torsion, if I have bending and torsion, that is load line is perpendicular to the centroidal axis with which we have externally applied torque. Such cases, the total stress will be principal stress. Sigma total will be sigma bending by 2 plus square root of sigma bending by 2 whole square plus tau square. We know sigma b, bending equation, that is mb into c by I. We know tau, which is tr by j. So calculating which, I can find the total stress induced, depending on which I can find out the required unknown or the total stress induced in the machine member. Next, if we have the 6th case, that is direct plus bending, which I have not mentioned there, that is direct plus bending. If I have direct and bending, the examples are we have loading cases with which load is coaxial and one more load is perpendicular, F1 and F2. Using F2, I can calculate the direct stress. Using F1, I can calculate the bending stress. Or, a very important note is that eccentric loading cases. If I have a machine member like this, whereas the centroidal axis is here, but the load line is parallel to the centroidal axis with eccentricity, eccentric loading. So direct plus bending is nothing but eccentric loading case. Very, very important eccentric loading cases. So such problems. So here I can find the bending moment as mb is equal to f into l, whereas here I should calculate the bending moment as mb is equal to f into eccentricity. So for this case, the total stress will be equal to sum of direct plus bending, that's all. Direct is force by area, bending is already known, mb into c by I. Now moving for the final probability of loading case, that is combined bending, direct and torsion. So for these cases, if I take an example, I can have a loading case like this. We have direct load plus two bending, in addition to which I will apply external torque. Or eccentric loading with torque like this. So we have a machine member, we have a centroidal axis where the load line is with certain amount of eccentricity. Eccentricity, and I have a torque P. Torque P is applied. So eccentric with torsion loading is a combination of all the three, direct bending and torsional loading case. For these cases, first you should find the value of normal stress is the sum of direct plus bending, and you should find the value of shear stress. So finally, sigma total will be maximum principal stress, that is sigma by 2 plus root of sigma by 2 whole square plus tau square. Key observation you should make here is the value of sigma is sum of direct plus bending. Apart from this, the value of sigma might be sigma direct plus or minus sigma bending. This is because of the reason, due to eccentricity at this point, the bending stress will cause tension. At this point, the bending stress will cause compression. So therefore, depending on the stress induced by bending stress, I should use plus or minus. If bending stress is causing tensile stress, then use sigma d plus sigma bending. If bending stress is causing compression, then use sigma d minus sigma bending. So here also, you should be careful. You should be sigma d plus or minus sigma bending whenever you have eccentric loading or loading like this. So if I take this point, the bending stress is causing tensile. If I take this point, the bending stress is causing compression. So these are the 7 probability of stress that can be induced due to the loading cases that has been specified in a problem for us. So this is the prerequisite to be known to solve problems on design for static stress. The 7 cases which I have discussed, how to identify based on the loading case to what category the machine member is subjected to among these 7. So here only I have specified 6. So one more is combined direct and bending. Direct plus bending case. So pure direct loading for which stress is force by area. Pure bending for which stress is MB into C by I. Pure torsion for which shear stress is T into R by J. Direct plus torsion. Direct plus torsion is maximum principal stress. Sigma principal should be calculated. Bending and torsion also should go for principal stress. For combined loading cases, should go for principal stress. So this also sigma principal stress. Only for this direct plus bending, the total stress is sum of direct plus bending. So with this very brief introduction to identify to what type of loading case the given machine member is subjected to, accordingly we should solve the problem. Let me pause this video for a while so that you people can copy it down and understand properly, so that we can solve one or two problems in this lecture. The problem number 1 of our discussion of design for static strength states that a beam of uniform rectangular cross section is fixed at one end and carries a load of 1000 Newton at a distance of 300 mm from the free end. The maximum bending stress in the beam is 80 MPa. Find the width and depth of the beam if the depth is twice the width. Now let us draw the sketch for the description what he has given. Thereby I can understand to what category the problem comes and lies among those 7 different varieties which we have discussed just now. So coming for the first problem solution, if I see, we have a beam of uniform rectangular cross section is fixed at one end. So it is fixed at one end, and since he has not said anything about other end, let us take it as free. Since it is not fixed at other end, that's why he is not specified. So now, if I see the side view, it is a rectangular cross section. The cross section is rectangle. We have width B and depth as H. It carries a load of 1000 Newton. So it is carrying a load of 1000 Newton at a distance of 300 mm from fixed end. At a distance of 300 mm from fixed end. The maximum bending stress in the beam is 80 MPa. So it is given the maximum bending stress, sigma bending, is 80 MPa and he is stating that find the width and depth of the beam if depth is twice the width. So this is the problem given. So now through the visual inspection itself I can state that for the centroidal axis the line of action of load is perpendicular. So therefore, this is the case of pure bending. This is the case of pure bending. So for pure bending case, we know that sigma total, the total stress induced is nothing but pure bending stress. So therefore, the design will be based on bending stress. Sigma B is given by MB into C by I. So now calculate, individually we have MB is equal to F in real, known for cantilever beam. So load F is 1000 Newtons into distance is 300 mm. So which gives us the value as 3 into 10 to the power of 5 Newton millimeters. Now we know the value of C. C is distance of the outer fibers from centroidal axis. Since this is a rectangular cross section, if I take from center, the distance will be h by 2. Distance of the outer fibers from centroidal axis, C is h by 2. It states that h is 2b. So therefore, I will get 2b by 2, which is equal to b. Now we know moment of inertia I. Moment of inertia I is given by bh cube by 12 for rectangle, which is a standard result. Or else you can also refer the data handbook, table number 1.3 for I and C values for various cross sections. So if I substitute and solve, I will get b into h is 2b whole cube by 12. Now further simplifying which, I will get the value as 2 cube is 8. 8 by 12 can be written as 2 by 3. 4 2 is 8, 4 3 is 12, 2 by 3. B cube into B is B power 4. So this is equal to 2 by 3rd of B to the power of 4. Now we know all the values. So therefore, substitute to this equation, I will end up with sigma B is known to me. Sigma B is 80 MPa. So therefore, 80 MPa is equal to MB is 3 into 10 to the power of 5 into C is B divided by I is 2 by 3 B power 4. So therefore, if I solve, I will get the value of B as 17.78, which can be approximated as 18 millimeters. So therefore, H is equal to 2B, which is equal to 18 to the 36 millimeters. So this is the solution for the given problem. The width of the beam is 18 mm, whereas the depth of the beam is 36 mm. So this is the solution for problem number 1. If I solve for problem number 2, the problem number 2, which has appeared in December 18 and January 19 VTU examination, states that a cantilever beam of rectangular cross section with a depth of 150 mm is subjected to an axial tensile load of 40 kN. and a transverse load of 50 kN acting downwards at the free end of 600 mm long beam. The material of the beam has allowable tensile stress of 100 MPa, determining the width of the rectangular cross section of beam. Let us draw the diagram for the description what he has given for problem number 2. So to solve for problem number 2, we have a cantilever beam with rectangular cross section. If I draw the side view, the cross section is found to be rectangle. So for which we have width and depth. With a depth of 150 mm, he has given the depth as 150 mm. It is subject to an axial tensile load of 40 kN. Along the axis, we have a tensile load of 40 kN and a transverse load of 50 kN acting downwards at the free end. So this is a free end at which we have a transverse load perpendicular to the centroidal axis, whose magnitude is 50 kN at free end of 600 mm long beam. So length of the beam is given as 600. All dimensions are in millimeters. The material of the beam has allowable tensile stress. He has given sigma allowable or sigma max as 100 MPa. And he is asking us to calculate the width of the beam required for the loading condition. So this is the pictorial view of the description what he has given. I want to find the value of B. Let us solve this problem. So if you clearly observe, 40 kN is coaxial and 50 kN is perpendicular to the centroidal axis. Therefore, this is the case of combined direct plus bending loading cases. So this is how you should identify the loading condition. So this is the case of combined direct and bending loading cases, for which you already know that total stress sigma total is equal to sigma direct plus sigma bending plus or minus sigma bending. Now if I observe at point A and point B, let me take two different points for analysis. If I observe, this bending stress will cause tensile at point A, whereas at point B, this bending stress will cause compression. So therefore, the critical section will be at point A, where which the total stress induced will be the sum of direct plus bending. And is also given the allowable stress as tensile stress. So therefore, I should analyze at section A. So therefore, at point A, the bending stress induces tensile loading case. So outer fibers are subjected for expansion, whereas inner fibers are subjected for compression. So hence we know the total stress allowable is 100 MPa. We know the formulas. So therefore, if I substitute and solve sigma total, so at point A, first I should write it as sigma total, which is nothing but sigma allowable is equal to sigma direct plus sigma bending. Sigma allowable is 100 MPa, which is equal to direct stress is known to us, force by area, plus bending stress is given by MB into C by I. So therefore, 100 is equal to force at induced for direct stress is 40 kN, 40 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by cross sectional area is width into depth, B into H is 150, plus bending stress. The bending is caused due to load into perpendicular distance, so therefore it is 50 kN into 600, 50 into 10 to the power of 3 into 600 is the bending moment, into C is the distance of the outer fibers from centroidal axis, which is nothing but H by 2, which is 150 by 2, divided by moment of inertia of a rectangle is bh cube by 12 b into 150 cube by 12. So further simplification yields us the further simplification can be made as I can take one more bit common. So it will be 40 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by 150 plus 50 into 10 to the power of 3 into 600 into 150 by 2 is 75. Let me take this 12 to numerator into 12 divided by 150 cube. So therefore, if I solve this and get the value of B as 82.667, which is nearly equal to 83. So the width for the loading condition required is 83 millimeters. So this is solution for problem number 2. So this is how you should identify the loading case and use appropriate formula to solve the problems in design for statics. In our next lecture, I will take up few more problems on design for static strength. That's all from today's lecture. Thank you all.